Hey everybody, Jazzy here. Here is the recap for year 17 of Thrill of the Grill, my solo Warly World over on Twitch. Last night of summer, we were very rudely interrupted with a hound wave, so first night of autumn, we're picking up where we left off with the Forest Stalker. I'm mainly looking to grab foliage so that I can craft up enough slimy turf for the bee park that we're building. I never knew that one of the fern variants actually gives you two foliage when picked, and the Forest Stalker spawns both types. This is great. It makes harvesting foliage probably easier than it should be. Can you imagine if they ever make foliage a crockpot ingredient like they do in Hamlet? It's worth like a whole veggie. Yeah, that'd be broken. By day 1123, all the new slimy turf has been crafted and placed in the build. When laying it down, I was thinking of a main road cutting straight through, and then smaller roads snaking out in all directions. And now from above, it looks like tree roots. I'm not gonna appreciate this once we start adding more details, so I'm taking time to appreciate it now. I'm finally hammering the bee boxes we've been relying on since the early days of this world. It is time to move on to bigger and better builds. But mostly bigger. This is gonna create a collection of homeless bees that are gonna end up doing something very interesting, but we'll talk about that in a minute. For now, we can start catching bees and placing our first bee boxes in the park. I'm not sticking to any regimented design format here, but the general idea for each little patch is to place bee boxes on the outside near a road, and then fill in the center area with flowers. We'll start with those building blocks and then expand and develop from there. We're not gonna have enough honeycomb, which is why I spend a day busting down all of the remaining beehives in the world. We did not get a whole lot generated with this world, and there's only 9 wild beehives left. We got more in the loot world, but I think that between the original bee boxes and these new honeycomb, we might have just enough to finish this one build. If we ever want more bee boxes though, we're getting it from over there. I'm also trying to re-catch or just dispatch most of the bees that got freed when I hammered my bee boxes. Homeless bees will pollinate flowers and plant new ones, even on turf where flowers would not generally be plantable. I'm getting flowers on cobblestone, and I don't really like it. It's also not a great idea having red bees flying around my gecko pen. I'm planting the berry bushes in the park, and I'm trying to plant an even amount of each variety while keeping the types consistent within each zone. For example, one plot will have leafy bushes, and the next plot over will have regular ones. I'm also planting birch nut trees all along the coastline, and in an effort to conceal the lightning rods as much as possible, I'm planting one tree directly in front of each rod. That's it for the autumn building. In winter, I really wanted to go spend some more time in the loot world and map out as much of the mainland as possible, just to get a sense of the biomes and all the resources available. So I'm throwing on a beefalo hat and a magiluminescence and doing a power run around the edge. One of the first biomes we come across is a rocky biome, which is probably the only overworld biome I was really praying for. This is where we will get our rocky turf for the foreseeable future. I am very thankful for this discovery. A couple days later, Clops spawns on us, well ahead of her estimated arrival. It seems likely that for two connected overworlds, you'd get a separate Clops timer for each map. This is kind of cool because if I really wanted to, I could double the bosses each season. 2 Clops fights, 2 Clops. Even alternate bee queens or dragonflies if I wanted to fight them more frequently than 20 days. I still can't believe this. Look at this beauty of a second rocky biome on the map. It's almost like they took all the rocky turf I was supposed to get on my main world and shove it onto this map on top of the rocky turf it already had. If we ever turn both of these biomes into cobblestone, I will be genuinely amazed. I don't see it happening in thousands of days, but you never know. Anyways, I'm done oogling the loot world for now. It's time to go home and fight Klaus. One of my long-term goals with this fight is to eventually have a no-damage kill. It's possible, but really challenging because of the freeze attack. If I had any notion of pulling that off on this fight, it was quickly shattered when I took some really stupid hits. And then it just devolved into one of the sloppiest Klaus fights I've had on this world so far. And immediately afterwards, we get the main world Klops, right on time. Since we got 2 eyeballs in a single winter via questionably legitimate means, chat guilted me into feeding one of the eyeballs to Cheesecake. And even if I starve the poor guy most of the year, nobody can deny that when he does eat, he eats like a king. After that, I rushed straight over to the Moonstone to do the event, and the Moonstone was broken. I'm wondering if the event runs off screen if I leave a staff in the Moonstone, Maybe by default it just breaks the pad and spawns some suspicious statues nearby. I'm gonna try that again and see if it happens during the next full moon. And now I finally get to open the Kloss loot, which is a shroom skin and some jelly. That might make for some interesting bee park decor, so I'm holding on to it for a minute. It's spring, so at this point I'm only really able to work on the park at dusk and night, because the red bees just make it impossible to move statues around during the day. I'm also gonna throw down a crockpot and cook up some jelly beans. The terracotta crockpot skin fits perfectly. It fits perfectly with the color theme of this build. While the bees are horny, it's a good time to work on the entryway to the park. I want the road leading up to be lined with scaled furnaces and moon dials. I don't have a ton of moon rocks, so the dials will be a work in progress. I'm also gonna wall off the outside of the park with a combination of thulisite and stone walls. I find that if you knock down a wall one level from default, it makes taller walls seem taller. So I'm upgrading the thulisite walls to full and knocking down the stone walls one level. For the walkway, I'm throwing up some astral detectors for light. They're gonna provide just enough light to keep the walkway safe without totally lighting it up. Astral detectors have a really small hitbox, and it's fun finding places to sneak them in for free light. They're not that expensive, all things considered. After hundreds of days of farming, I finally get a fire nettle popping up in the farm plots. I had no clue how to get rid of it, so I just tried picking it, as if I would try to pick real-life nettles with my bare hands. Overheating took me down by half my health before I figured it might be worth throwing up a polar light to cool off. And now I'm back in the loot world. I'm just spending a few days digging up tons of rocky turf. Because this is a survival world, I want to make sure to have a meat effigy set up in every shard, just in case Jazzy makes a boo-boo. We got a hound wave, and fortunately, beehives make for great hound wave distractions. Just smack a couple hives and wait for the hounds to aggro on them. So it's nice to have plenty of natural defenses everywhere in a part of the world that we're not actively fortifying. Returning home very triumphantly with 32 stacks of rocky turf. It's gonna be a few years before we can turn all this into roads. I'm also doing a quick stone fruit harvest and using a lazy forager to quickly pick up 4 stacks of stone fruit to bundle up. It's actually a very good use of the forager because stone fruit spoils so quickly and the faster you can pick it up, the better. Then I'll just pick the rocks and burn the rest of the fruit. Looking ahead to summer, I want to go hunting for some scorching sunfish. I hear they're quite useful for keeping warm in winter, and for future sailing trips, it'll be nice to not need a fire pit on board. Now, sunfish apparently have the best utensil etiquette because, as far as bait goes, they really like spoons and sporks. Are there any other fish that prefer spoons over spinnerbaits? I was under the impression that spinnerbaits were universally better, but then I learned. Dark Pulse has a very good quick reference sheet for each fish and their preferred baits. I'll share the link in the description. Anyways, we need mushroom caps for the spoons, so I'm doing a quick scavenge in the deciduous biome just so that I can make a handful of different spoons. First stop in early summer is over to the seaweeds to harvest the barnacles. First and last 2 days of summer are safe from wildfires, but once those start up, we're gonna wanna stay the hell away from our boats and our seaweeds. Only bad things can happen around those. I'm also trying to grab a spittlefish while I'm out here. They like seeds and berries, but they're still kind of a pain to get nibbling. It takes a bit of patience. It might not be a bad idea to install some water pumps on some of my boats, especially for ones that I plan to sail during summer. And here we spot our first sunfish herd. After the spittlefish, these are really easy to snag with the right bait. I'm told to pick up the fish as soon as I catch them because apparently they make nearby stuff smolder. Back home, I had waited a couple days for hounds, but because I was out to sea for a while, I didn't know if I had skipped a hound wave, so I just got impatient and fired up the antlion fight, and was immediately punished with a hound wave. I like to think that if I hadn't started the fight, they would have waited another 2 days to start barking, and I probably would have gotten sinkholes instead. So we grabbed another thermal and restarted the antlion fight. I didn't intend to deal the finishing blow with the walking cane, I was just trying to keep her aggroed while waiting for her to summon some fresh sandcastles. But I only had a low durability fire staff, so I'm not sure how many castles I had planned on farming anyways. The rest of the summer was dedicated to the bee park. I'm finally able to move around all the statues that I've wanted to install, and I just hang around catching and planting butterflies. I'd be lying if I said this wasn't one of the more peaceful projects I've done. Definitely a mellower summer than clearing the ruins. I want to put up another decorative crockpot, but I'm out of royal jelly. So instead of jelly beans, we cook up some ambrosia. You need the collected dust recipe from the archives, and then just throw it into a pot with any filler for some eternal nachos. I wish the sprite was higher quality, but I think it fits the build nicely. Last day of summer, I'm heading back to the seaweeds to pick more barnacles after the threat of wildfires has passed. If I manage to grab the barnacles and plant my birch nut seeds right before the start of every autumn, I think we'll be in good shape going forward. Next year, we're gonna finish up the bee park. We're gonna give our pet Four Stalker a proper build. We're going to wall off an entire biome. We're gonna rock another Fuel Weaver, and then we're gonna go straight for the ruins. I hope you're enjoying the recaps, and maybe next time we can catch you live over on Twitch. Take care.